You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
Can't buy me love.
What's up, y'all? I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. As it is the 3 o'clock hour, it is Maggie and the Millionaires talking money. This week, we're talking about global power and money. Talking about how money and power operate internationally, not just in the United States, and how they affect things in your family and here at home. We're kicking off with an explosive new report from Oxfam International, which is out today. Its title is Multilateralism in an Era of Global Oligarchy: How Extreme Inequality Undermines International Cooperation. And tomorrow, the UN General Assembly, convening in New York City, begins a high-level debate about global inequality. So to talk about this and what it means, we have two very special guests. First, Nabil Ahmed, Director of Economic and Racial Justice at Oxfam America. Nabil leads Oxfam's agenda on economic and racial justice. He's authored and co-authored flagship Oxfam reports, including Inequality Kills and Inequality Inc. He was formerly a national organizer, worked in the private sector at Unilever, and is a graduate of the University of Manchester in UK. I'm also joined by Scott Ellis, the founder of the Excessive Wealth Disorder Institute. Welcome, gentlemen. Thank you so much for being here. Nabil, I'm going to jump right in. This report is pretty shocking. And people here in the United States, and I think any polling, it doesn't matter which poll you look at, shows that people have this anxiety, this feeling that things are not as they should be. They have this great intuitive sense about these extraordinary levels of inequality. But I don't think the scale of what this is, either here in the United States or globally, is widely understood. How bad has wealth inequality become? How much money do the ultra wealthy and corporations really control?
Maggie, this is an amazing question, and thank you so much for having us on. And thank you for your bravery and your willingness to be able to talk about these issues. It's a great question. Look, you know, we can look back in history and we think of those moments that are etched in our minds and we're taught from a young age, like the Gilded Age, you know, and think of the robber barons of that time. Well, guess what? If you look at the data, wealth concentration at the top in the United States today has actually surpassed the peak even of that era as well, right? Yep. We are living in a second Gilded Age. And I like the way you set up the question, right? Because we can look here in the United States and yes, there are record levels of wealth concentration. In fact, if you look at just the top 0.1% in the United States, it's just hit its highest recorded peak of wealth since records began. And we can talk about America, but this is also a global story. And by the way, America drives that global story. Yes. This report that we have out today, it shows that the world's richest 1%, they own more wealth than 95% of the world put together, right? We know extreme wealth concentration has been getting worse for decades, but since 2020, it's just gone off the charts, Maggie. It's really hard even to put it in the words. Let me put it this way. Just think of the five richest people in the world. Okay, the five, and by the way, they're all men, no surprise. Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos, and their buddies, right?
Yeah.
Their wealth has doubled since 2020 to over $800 billion. That's just the five richest people, right? And at the same time, the world's nearly 5 billion people, that's 60% of the world, they've actually seen their wealth fall, right? They've got poorer. If you just were to plot this on a chart to say, okay, Nabil, where are these trends going at current rates? And listeners may want to just kind of just bear with me here for a second. At current rates, we could see the world's first trillionaire within a decade from now, a trillionaire, a word that shouldn't even exist.
Right.
And at the same time, at current rates, it would take over 200 years to end poverty. That's where things are heading. That's what the data shows. And that is incredibly frightening for all of us.
Scott, when you talk about wealth inequality, you talk about it as a disorder. Why?
I think a lot of it aligns to what our colleague has just been talking about. As this is all happening and it's becoming increasingly clear, a lot of the collective response is, okay, anyway, it's Tuesday, what's on TV? We're very worried about differences, as we should be, in the gender pay gap and in the racial wage gap of either percentage points or several times. But when we look at differences in wealth of thousands of times or 10,000 times higher, we don't have outrage. We're not immediately focusing this on this as a priority. And I think when we talk about who has excessive wealth disorder, on one hand, it's the wealthy folks who, even though they have more than they can ever spend, continue to seek more, et cetera, et cetera. But it's also regular people at home too, because as they should be, they're focused on living their lives, but they're not seeing how big this issue is, how important it is, and how important it is to address it and seek change.
Yeah, when we think about these issues, and I appreciate you bringing up gender and gender pay gaps and racial wage gaps and the dispersion, the disparate levels of household wealth that we see, but those categories are subsumed by leaps and bounds exponentially of this extraordinary level of wealth inequality, again, not seen in our country since the Gilded Age, the time of the robber barons and monopolies. That's the concentration that we're starting to see. But this report from Oxfam and Nabil is not just about inequality. It's about oligarchy. It's about how the ultra-wealthy use their wealth to amass and retain political power and to exercise that power to continue to amass ever increasing amounts of wealth and power. It just keeps replicating itself. What are some of the examples of this operating here in the real world?
You're so right, Maggie. Oh, by the way, I wish radio stations across the country talked about these issues in the way that we're doing right now, because this is, for me, this is a number one issue and we can't avoid it. And I'll answer your question. Just before I do that, you mentioned the racial wealth gap there.
Yes.
Check this out. The racial wealth gap in the United States today, in 2020, which is when the research went up to, in 2020, the racial wealth gap is the same as it was in 1950. Mm. Imagine it actually started to get better, and then it got worse as extreme wealth concentration got worse. Yes. That also set back the racial wealth gap in this country. And it's, yes, so important that we look at that. And you're right. These aren't just billionaires that we're talking about. They're also oligarchs, because there is a power dimension to this, right? Wealth breeds power, power breeds wealth. And if you just look at some of the industries that we're talking about here, you know, sometimes we look at corporations and we think, oh, they're just corporations. They're kind of just working for shareholders. There's a lot more to the story. In fact, if you look at just the world's 10 largest corporations, 7 of them are either run by a billionaire or have one as a principal shareholder, which is a very powerful,
yes,
role. And across industries, we've seen how billionaires have cornered markets. Check this out. You know, 2 companies today control 40% of the global seed market. That used to be 10 companies 25 years ago. You know, 10 giant big pharma firms have actually merged from over 60 two decades ago. Just one company, Google, gets 90% of global search. You know, I could go on with these examples. Not only do you have corporations which have grown their power and consolidated more power across industries, you've also seen the power within those corporations entrenched in fewer and fewer hands. That gives them a huge amount of influence over the rules, over the norms in our economies. And let's be clear, they benefit from this. You know, 8 out of every $10 of profits is going back into the hands of the extremely wealthy. That's who the large corporations are paying out to. We have to be talking about extreme inequality, and we have to be talking about this global oligarchy.
Nabil, when you mention the consolidation in these industries, the 3 that you picked, and we could look at almost any industry, we're seeing this consolidation, not just within the United States, but globally as well, vertical and horizontal integration. The 3 that you mentioned, I think, are worth emphasizing here. The seed market, that is the world's food supply, okay? That it's absolutely critical, incredible consolidation there. Google, it's effectively access to information. Whose information gets elevated? What do you see first? What are you most likely to consume? And then you talked about pharmaceuticals, the very drugs that so many of us rely on to live. We could go on and on, but you just take the three that happened off the top of your head, and it is truly, truly scary. And again, when we talk about corporations creating profit, this fact that you mentioned that $8 of $10 of profit goes back to the wealthiest shareholders, not folks that have our 401ks and a little bit of this or that right. and a mutual fund. No, no, no. It's not accruing to our benefit. It's accruing to that oligarchical class. Scott, when we start to think about solutions to this problem, what pops to mind, perhaps top of the list?
I mean, for me, the key mechanism is tax policy. I mean, there is a structure for this. It's about all of us agreeing on what the rules for our society and our economy should be. In a democratic society, the power should be with the people, with the voters, to define the rules of the game. And a lot of times we talk about capitalism and making this work, and we want to make sure we manage government regulation effectively. Absolutely right. Make sure companies are able to move forward and make decisions, but we need to set the rules of the game. And right now the rules have been set up in a way that advantage the excessively wealthy. And as Nabil has said, and the excessively wealthy are using this power to continue to shape the rules. We need to recognize that's happening. We need to think about it as individual citizens and voters. And then we need to use tax policy to manage the extreme accumulation of wealth.
And I want to make this distinction clear here, Nabil. When we talk about making regulations more efficient, that's effectively in the details of the rules of industry. What we're talking about is policy decisions at a much, much higher level and who effectively gets to benefit when economies boom. Is that fair to say? Again, we're not talking about regulations in the details. We're talking about the highest level of policymaking, tax policy and the like.
Absolutely, yes. We're talking about tax policy. We're talking taxing the ultra-rich and corporations. We're talking about things like labor policy,
yes,
right? Ensuring that workers have their rights, get paid, you know, should be paid a living wage, can have the rights to organize. We're talking about things like anti-monopoly,
yes,
you know, so that we don't have these massive corporations that can, you know, shape the democracies or so-called democracies in their favor. And in each one of these as well, Maggie, guess what? And maybe we can go into this. There's a rich history of government that fights back for working people on across all these areas. It's been done before. We can do it again.
Government should work for you and me, the middle and working class folks. My special guest, Nabil Ahmed, Director of Economic and Racial Justice at Oxfam America, with a absolutely groundbreaking report coming out today, joined also by Scott Ellis, Excessive Wealth Disorder Institute founder. I'm Maggie Dawn. We'll be back with more after these important messages on the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome back, everybody. My name's Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. We're in the first half of the 3 o'clock hour, and that means it is Maggie and the Millionaires talking money. I've got two great guests today. Nabil Ahmed, Director of Economic and Racial Justice at Oxfam. They have released a report today titled Multilateralism in an Era of Global Oligarchy. Tomorrow, the United Nations kicks off a big debate on this explosion of inequality, really getting turbocharged since COVID. We're also joined by Scott Ellis, founder of the Excessive Wealth Disorder Institute. Nabil, we've been talking about this symbiotic relationship between the ultra wealthy, tax policy, labor policy. And what that's code for is basically the ultra wealthy being able to control the levers of government and to enact and achieve the policies that they wish to see. And by doing so, further enrich themselves and further consolidate power. But the history here is rich and it goes back quite a ways. This didn't just pop out of nowhere, did it?
No, it didn't. It didn't. Now we're seeing actually we're at the peak of a period that's lasted a few decades where the very richest in our society and the corporations that they control have really got their way through lobbying, through shaping norms and rules in their favor, and they're massively from it. And that's how there's been such a concentration of wealth. But what people maybe don't know as much is that there has been a different time too, as well. I look at the period after World War II, for example, in the United States, and we by no way want to say this was like a time in which things were perfect. There were still gaps, you know, especially people of color weren't able to gain as much as others. But we've also got to say that was a period in which we saw some progressive legislation. Let's just talk about one of the issues that we've talked about today, tax, right? There were efforts to ensure that the richest in society were paying their fair share. President FDR literally went to Congress and he proposed a rate of 100% of the very top tax rate on the very richest people in the United States. He didn't get 100%. They settled for 94%.
Yeah.
And over a three to four decade period, that top marginal income tax rate in the United States, it averaged 81% until the early 80s. People are shocked when we hear this. And that was also a period in which the middle class grew, in which there was investment in innovation and infrastructure in the United States, even put a man on the moon. So I think we can like learn from the experience of moments like this to say we can actually do policy a different way. We can look in the United States into its history. There are other countries that have done things a better way, but we also got to be clear-eyed to say things have gone in the wrong way. In country after country, it's a global trend, and we need to put the brakes on this extreme wealth concentration. It's not just an academic issue. It's something that affects us all. Sorry, Maggie.
No. Please, listen. I'd like somebody to ask the former MAGA president to make America great again. Then I presume that you endorse an 81% effective tax rate for billionaires, sir. That would certainly start to close some of the gaps. Scott, you've thought about this quite a bit. When you hear some of these statistics from Oxfam's report, that the world's top 1%, the most wealthy, own more wealth than 95% of us. What should we be doing in response?
I think the first step is like, wake up, America. This is what's happening. This is real. People have been working very hard to hide this fact, to distract you from it, to get you to talk about other things. And I think, like we're doing right now, we should be talking about money. People need money. How do you help get a house for yourself and your family, pay for kids for college, live a wonderful life for yourself, work hard and get the benefits of that? That's the system we should have. We all need to be aware that it's being abused and exploited by a very small number of people to enrich themselves and hurt the rest of us. And so I think a lot of it's about all of us realizing this is happening, realizing we do have power, which is to vote to change the rules. And then we need to change the conversation. And we should be talking about wealth. We should be talking about what financial success means and what's enough, and then decide how to limit it when people, congratulations to them, they've achieved success. How do we limit it when they've gone beyond that so they don't undermine our capitalism and our democracy?
Scott, very quick follow-up. I've had callers that call in and say, listen, I want to be able to leave a couple million to my kids, et cetera, et cetera. And I say, we're not talking about you. We're talking about people with 30, 40, 50 million in net worth. We're not talking about middle class workers that are trying to leave something or help their kids buy a house. We're not talking about that. I have people call in and say, well, what about the small businesses? And we raise a corporate tax rate. And I say, listen, if you're a small business and you got a lot of expenses, we're talking about taxes on corporate profits. What is your brief response, Scott, to people that say those things? Because I always want us to take care that we're not trying to tax those folks. It's not you. If you're listening to the show, we're probably not talking about you, right?
Yeah. I mean, I basically say, do you have $30 million? If you so, congratulations. If you have less than $30 million, everything I'm talking about will only help you by making a fairer and better system. If you have over $30 million, I want to have a conversation, and I am going to ask for your help. Another way I've been thinking about this is, let's just talk about how many houses you can own.
Yeah.
Everyone
can
own one house. That'd be wonderful. Maybe two, maybe three. Is it okay to own five? How about 10? Well, if it costs like $30 billion to buy every house in Milwaukee, and Elon has $247 billion, he could buy every house in Milwaukee and like almost a million other houses. That's what we're talking about.
Yeah, so it's wealth at that level. Yes, excessive wealth. Nabil, the G20 is set to meet in November, and one of the items that they're discussing is an international agreement for a minimum tax on billionaires. Oxfam has that idea and a few others. Tell us about that. We got about a minute left, sir.
Yeah, absolutely. Sure. So we need to implement these progressive kind of policies. We need to do them in every country, but we also need to act at the international level. Brazil has shown leadership at the international level. It leads a G20 group of countries, and it's been trying to put forward this proposal to say, let's get to a global standard in which we're taxing the very, 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 very wealthy in every country, to tax billionaires. And they've pushed other nations. They've got us to a place in which, for the first time in history, the G20 countries came together and said, okay, actually, we do need to tax the rich, and we'll begin to cooperate to do so. We've got a whole long way to be able to get to where we really need to get to, but it shows we can't tackle this problem in only one country alone. What do billionaires do? They'll stash their money away. They'll find a way out, but you need to cooperate. And then, you know what, Maggie? That's a bit of hope as well.
I certainly hope so. Go G20. Go Nabil. My two special guests, Nabil Ahmed, Director of Economic and Racial Justice at Oxfam America, Scott Ellis, founder of the Excessive Wealth Disorder Institute. Whew, these segments go so fast, gents. We're going to have to leave it there. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network, back with Dom Selvey after these important messages.
You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.